Assalamualaikum students, I am Dr. Ikra and today's practical is clinical examination of 8th cranial nerve or the vestibulocochlear nerve. First of all, a little bit of introduction about the 8th vestibulocochlear nerve is that it is a sensory nerve which consists of two sets of fibers. The auditory portion of the nerve fibers originates from the cochlear apparatus and they are responsible for the hearing. The vestibular portion of the nerve fibers originates from the vestibular apparatus and they are responsible for balance and equilibrium. The test for the auditory or cochlear fibers to find out if the function of the auditory fibers is intact are watch test, voice or whisper test, tuning fork test and audiometry. The apparatus that is required to carry out these tests are tuning forks in any frequency 256 Hz, 512 Hz or 1256 Hz. A rubber pad, we will also require some ear plugs, an adjustable stool, a simple watch and also a stopwatch. Now we will discuss the procedure of these four tests. First of all, the thing is the watch test. It is a very simple test which is only applicable when the hearing loss in the subject or the patient is very slight. The procedure for that is, first of all, make the subject sit in a quiet room comfortably and approach him from the right side. Introduce yourself, explain the procedure and take his consent. After that, ask the subject to close his or her eyes and then find out the distance at which he or she is able to hear the ticking sound of a watch. The procedure is repeated on the opposite side or the opposite ear. The procedure for the voice or whisper test is that the subject is made to sit in a quiet room at a distance of about 5.5 meter from the examiner with his eyes closed. His face is turned to one side, presenting the testing ear to the examiner, and the opposite ear is blocked or plugged with a cotton plug. Make a soft whisper from the distance of 5.5 meter and observe whether the subject is able to perceive this whisper or not. A normal subject will hear a whisper, a soft whisper, from a distance of 5.5 meter. If the subject is unable to hear those whispered words, make a conversational voice, that is, say some words softly and measure the distance at which it is heard by the subject. If the subject is still unable to hear these softly spoken words, make a loud noise from the same distance of 5.5 meter and record the distance at which the subject will be able to hear that voice. Okay students, now we will have a look at the apparatus which will be used in these tests to conduct the hearing test. First of all, we will require this watch. It makes a ticking sound. These are the earplugs which will be used to plug the ear. This is a stopwatch and these are the tuning forks. You can see that the size of tuning fork is different and the frequency is also written on top of the tuning fork. Okay students, now we will have the procedure for the voice test and the watch test. First of all, we will perform the watch test. In this, the subject is placed or seated in a stool in a quiet setting. We will ask him to close his eyes, but first of all, I will introduce myself, I will explain the procedure and I will take the consent. Assalamu alaikum, mera naam Dr. Ikra hai. Maine aaj aapki kaan ki sunai check karne ke liye aapke upar kuch test karne hai. तो उसमें आप मेरी मदद करेंगे, आप मुझे इजाज़त देते हैं उसके लिए?
इजाज़त है, ठीक है.
अब आप ऐसा करें, आप अपनी आंखें बंद कर लें. नाउ वी विल इंट्रोड्यूस अ टिकिंग साउंड फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस ऑफ 30 सेंटीमीटर फ्रॉम हिज टेस्टिंग ईयर. अ नॉर्मल सब्जेक्ट विल बी एबल टू हेयर द टिकिंग साउंड ऑफ द वॉच फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस ऑफ अबाउट 30 सेंटीमीटर. You can use a simple watch or an apparatus like this. Now I will ask my subject if he has heard any sound. जी, आपको कोई आवाज़ आ रही है?
आ रही है मुझे.
So that means that he is able to hear the sound of a ticking watch from a distance of 30 centimeter. Okay, now we will have a look at the procedure for the voice or whisper test. For this procedure, the subject is again seated in a quiet setting. After introduction, procedure explanation and consent, I will ask my subject to close his eyes and turn the testing ear towards the examiner, which is seated at a distance of 5.5 meter away from the subject. And the opposite ear will be plugged with the help of a cotton plug. आप ऐसा करें, आप अपनी आंखें बंद कर लें और अपना चेहरा जो है अपनी बाएं तरफ जो है वो कर लें और अपने बाएं जो कान है उसको आप बंद कर लें इस कॉटन प्लग की मदद से. Now, we will introduce a very soft whisper from a distance of 5.5 meter. He has said a word in a whispered voice and now I will ask my subject whether he has heard that voice. जी, आपको कोई आवाज़ आई है? आवाज़ नहीं आई? A normal subject will be able to hear that voice from a distance of 5.5 meter. But now he wasn't able to hear that voice. We will proceed with the next step with a slightly loud whisper. जी, अब आपको आवाज़ आई है?
जी.
Now he is able to hear that whisper and we will record the distance, that is a distance of 5.5 meter in this case, in which he was able to hear that whispered voice. Now in a case in which he is even unable to hear that slightly soft whispered voice, we will introduce a stimulus of hearing from a distance of 5.5 meter in the form of a loud voice. And then I will ask my subject whether he was able to hear that voice and I will record that distance. Okay students, now we will discuss the tuning fork tests which are used to examine the vestibulocochlear nerve. The tuning fork tests are Rinne's test, Weber's test, Schwabach's test and modified Schwabach's test. First of all, we will discuss the Rinne's test in detail. The Rinne's test compares the bone conduction with the air conduction of the same ear in a subject. Plug one ear of the subject with a cotton plug and test the open ear. Strike the prongs of a tuning fork on a rubber pad or your hand and place its vibrating stem behind the ear on the mastoid process of the open ear. Now after a couple of seconds, bring the prong of the tuning fork while it is still vibrating close to the external auditory meatus of the subject and ask whether he is able to hear the vibrations or not. A normal subject will be able to hear the vibrations when the tuning fork is brought in front of the ear from the mastoid process, which shows that in a normal subject with normal hearing, the air conduction is better than the bone conduction because the subject hears the vibration of the tuning fork through the external auditory meatus after he has stopped perceiving them through the mastoid process. In this case, we will say that the Rinne's test is positive. Now we will discuss the interpretation of Rinne's test in detail. If the Rinne's test is positive, it shows that the air conduction is better than bone conduction, which is the case in a normal subject with normal hearing. And in this case, the subject will be able to hear the vibrations of the tuning fork when it is brought in front of the ear from the mastoid process. In case of a Rinne's negative test, the bone conduction will be better or greater than the air conduction. This is not a normal thing and it occurs in conductive deafness. In this case, the subject will not hear vibrations when the tuning fork is brought in front of the ear, which will show that his bone conduction is better than air conduction. And the air conduction is lessened or decreased due to the presence of conduction or conductive deafness in the testing open ear. Now, the Rinne's reduced positive means that both air conduction and bone conduction are decreased in the subject, but the air conduction is still better than the bone conduction. This occurs in nerve deafness. In nerve deafness, as the nerve is damaged, so both forms of hearing through the ear, that is the external auditory meatus, and through the bone, that is the Meister process or any other bone of the skull, will be decreased or impaired, but the ratio between the air conduction and bone conduction will be the same as in a normal subject. So air conduction will still be better than bone conduction in nerve deafness. In Rini's false negative, both air conduction and bone conduction are absent in the subject, and the subject will perceive some vibrations of the tuning fork through the bones of skull in the normal ear. This procedure of Rini's test is repeated on the opposite ear. So all the tuning fork tests are first proceeded on the testing ear and then repeated on the opposite ear. Now we will proceed towards the second tuning test, which is the Weber's test. In Weber's test, the bone conduction of one ear is compared with the bone conduction of the opposite ear of the same subject. In this procedure, no ear is plugged as both ears are tested at the same time. The procedure is like the tuning fork is struck on a rubber pad on your hand. The vibrating tuning fork is placed either on the center of the forehead or the vertex through the stem or the base. After that, ask the subject whether the sound is heard in both ears equally or it is heard better in one ear. In this case, ask the subject to point towards the ear in which he hears better vibrations. The interpretation of Weber test is, in a normal subject with normal hearing, the sound will be heard equally in both ears, and the subject will perceive sound as if it is coming from the midline position. In case of conductive deafness, the sound will be heard better in the ear with the conductive deafness. The reason for that is, in the defective ear, the masking effect of the environmental noise and also the damping mechanism of the tensor tympani and stapedius muscle is absent. So, the absence of both these mechanisms will not mask the environmental noise and will not damp the sound, and the ear will perceive the sound as louder than the normal ear. In case of nerve deafness, sound will be heard better in the normal ear because the defective ear has nerve deafness and neural activity is decreased in it, and due to the decrease or absence of neural activity, the defective ear will not be able to hear better. So, if sound is heard better in the defective ear, it means that the defective ear has conductive deafness, and if the sound is heard better in the normal ear, it means that the defective ear has nerve deafness. Okay, now we will proceed with the procedure of the tuning fork test. First of all, we will perform the Rini's test. In this, the subject is placed in a quiet setting in a stool and the examiner is about some distance away from the subject. One ear will be checked in this test, and I will ask the subject to plug his opposite ear with the help of a cotton plug and close his eyes. Like this. Assalamu alaikum. Mera naam Dr. Iqbal. मैंने आज आपकी कान की सुनाई चेक करने के लिए ट्यूनिंग फोर की मदद से जो है वो आपके ऊपर कुछ टेस्ट करने हैं, तो आपसे आप उसमें मेरा ताबून करेंगे और मुझे इजाज़त देते हैं इस चीज़ की? आप ऐसा करें, आप अपना जो बायां ईयर है उसको आप बंद कर लें इस कॉटन की मदद से और अपनी आँखें बंद कर लें. नाउ विद द हेल्प ऑफ अ ट्यूनिंग फोर इट इज़ स्ट्राइक ऑन द रबर पैड and placed on the mastoid process behind the ear like this. Now the tuning fork is brought in front of the external auditory meatus like this. Now I will ask my subject whether he was able to hear the vibrations when the tuning fork was brought in front of his ear. Acha, aap mujhe bataein jab wo aapko awaaz aayi hai jab wo aage lekar aaye. Theek hai, inko awaaz aayi. So in this case, we can say that the Rini's test is positive and the air conduction is better than the bone conduction. पॉज कर। नाउ इफ वी सपोज दैट द सब्जेक्ट हैज कंडक्टिव डेफनेस इन हिज ओपन एयर, इन दिस केस ही विल नॉट बी एबल टू हेयर द वाइब्रेशंस ऑफ द ट्यूनिंग फोर्ड व्हेन द ट्यूनिंग फोर्ड विल बी ब्रॉड फॉरवर्ड इन फ्रंट ऑफ हिज एयर। सो इन दिस केस इफ वी प्लेस द ट्यूनिंग फोर्ड, द वाइब्रेटिंग ट्यूनिंग फोर्ड ऑन हिज मेस्टॉइड प्रोसेस एंड देन ब्रिंग इट while it is still vibrating in front of his external auditory meters and ask him whether the vibrations are heard, he will say that the vibrations are not heard. जी आपको आवाज़ आई है जब वो आपके कान के आगे लेकर आए? So we are supposing that in this case his ear has conduction deafness and in this case the bone conduction will become better than the ear conduction and the Rini's test will be negative. Okay. Now we will see the procedure of the Weber's test. In the Weber's test, the bone conduction of one ear is compared with the bone conduction of the opposite ear in the same subject. In this procedure, no ear will be plugged as both ears will be checked at the same time. So first of all, I will show you the two points at which the vibrating tuning fork can be placed. It is either the center of the forehead. That is, place the stem of the tuning fork on the center of the forehead or the vertex of the skull, like this. So now we will proceed with the actual procedure. First of all, strike the tuning fork on the rubber pad and place its vibrating stem on the center of the forehead. Now I will ask my subject whether the sound is heard better in one ear or is heard equally in both ears. हाँ जी, आपको इसकी जो आवाज़ आ रही है वो दोनों कानों में एक जैसी आ रही है या एक कान में बेहतर आ रही है? सो ही हैज सेड दैट ही इज हेयरिंग द साउंड इक्वली इन बोथ ईयर्स। आपको क्या लग रहा है कि आपको आवाज़ कहाँ से आ रही है? वो ही इज सेइंग दैट द साउंड इज कमिंग फ्रॉम द मिड लाइन पोजिशन। सो इन दिस केस he has no conduction deafness or nerve deafness, his both ears have normal hearing and he is hearing equal sound of the tuning fork in both ears. Pause. Okay, now suppose that either the patient or the subject has conduction deafness or nerve deafness. In this case, when the tuning fork will be placed on the center of his forehead, he will perceive the sound better in either ear. हाँ जी, आपको ये जो आवाज़ आ रही है ये आपको दोनों कानों में एक जैसी सुनाई दे रही है या किसी कान में बेहतर सुनाई दे रही है?
कान में बेहतर सुनाई दे रही है।
किस कान में बेहतर सुनाई दे रही है?
लेफ्ट साइड
पे। सो आई हैव आस्क्ड द सब्जेक्ट टू पॉइंट आउट द ईयर इन विच द साउंड वॉज लेटरलाइज्ड। दिस मीन्स दैट हिज लेफ्ट ईयर कैन आइदर हैव कंडक्शन डेफनेस, इन विच केस द डिफेक्टिव ईयर विल हेयर द साउंड बेटर, और इट कैन ऑल्सो मीन दैट इज ऑपोजिट एयर दैट द राइट एयर कैन हैव नर्व डेफनेस। ओके स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ वी विल डिस्कस द थर्ड ट्यूनिंग फोर्क टेस्ट विच इज द शोबेक्स टेस्ट। इन द शोबेक्स टेस्ट द बोन कंडक्शन ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट इज कंपेयर्ड विद द बोन कंडक्शन ऑफ द एग्जामिनर एंड द एग्जामिनर शुड हैव नॉर्मल हेयर। प्लेस अ वाइब्रेटिंग ट्यूनिंग फोर्क ओवर द सब्जेक्ट्स मेस्टॉइड प्रोसेस and the other ear of the subject is plugged with the cotton plug and the same ear of the examiner is also plugged. When he is not able to hear any vibrations anymore, transfer the tuning fork to the your mastoid process or the mastoid process of the examiner. If the examiner is able to hear the tuning fork vibration, this shows that there is hearing loss in the subject because of nerve deafness, which means that the subject has nerve deafness in the open ear due to which he could not hear the vibrations as long as the examiner. If the examiner is unable to hear the tuning fork after transferring it to his mastoid process, it shows that the subject has conductive deafness. In conductive deafness, we have already discussed that due to the absence of the masking of the environmental noise and the damping mechanism, the subject actually hears louder sound in the defective ear. So, the subject with conductive deafness will hear the tuning fork longer than the examiner. The procedure is repeated on the opposite side, that is, if you were examining the right ear of the subject with that of the examiner, you will now plug it and also plug the ear of the examiner and proceed with it on the left ear. The interpretation of Shobeck's test tells us that in case of nerve deafness, the time of the tuning fork vibration is shortened by several seconds in the subject than the examiner. That is, the examiner will hear it longer than the subject. And in case of conductive deafness, the time is lengthened in the subject than the examiner. So the subject will hear the tuning fork longer than that of the examiner. So the next tuning fork test is the modified Shobeck's test. It is also known as absolute bone conduction or ABC test. In this test, the bone conduction of the subject is compared with the bone conduction of the examiner. The examiner should have normal hearing. But the only difference of this test from the normal Shobeck's test is that the external auditory meatus of both ears is closed in both the subject and the examiner. So the ear conduction of both ears is totally ruled out and only the bone conduction is tested in this way. The vibrating tuning fork is placed on the mastoid process of the subject on any side or any ear. When the subject stops perceiving the sound, the tuning fork is then placed on the mastoid process of the examiner. The time is recorded when either the subject or the examiner no more hears the sound. The interpretation of the modified Shobeck's test or the absolute bone conduction test tells us that in case of nerve deafness, the examiner will still be able to hear the vibrating tuning fork when the subject will be unable to hear it. And in case of conductive deafness, the subject hears the vibrations longer than the examiner. So these are the four tuning fork tests. After that, there is another procedure to check the hearing of a subject, which is audiometry, which will not be performing here in the lab, but you should be familiar with the concept. A pure tone audiometer is an instrument for measuring the hearing acuity. Audiometers are available in hospitals or in clinics. The subject listens to several tones in the range of 125 to 8000 Hz, and the subject's threshold of perceiving each tone is determined and is recordable as decibels of loudness and is plotted on an audiogram. Okay, now we will see the procedure of the Shobeck's test. In this, the bone conduction of the subject is compared with the bone conduction of an examiner with normal hearing. So first of all, I will ask both my subject and the examiner to plug their ears which are not being tested. आप ऐसा करें, आप अपने कान में जो है, अपने बाएं कान में वो कॉटन की मदद से उसको बंद करें. So you can see that both the subject and the examiner has occluded their left ear, and the test of Shobeck's test will be performed on the right ear of both the subject and the examiner. So now we will take the tuning fork, strike it on the rubber pad and place it on the mastoid process behind the right ear and notice the time on the stopwatch. We will start the stopwatch before placing the tuning fork on the mastoid process. Now the subject has indicated or pointed out that he has stopped hearing the vibrations. When the subject points that out, transfer the tuning fork stem on your own mastoid process and also look at the time. Now the examiner has also stopped hearing the vibrations. So in this case, you can see that the examiner heard the tuning fork vibrations longer than the subject, which shows that the subject has nerve deafness. So now we will suppose a condition in which the subject has conductive deafness. In this case, the subject will hear the tuning fork vibrations longer than the examiner. So if we proceed with this, we will see that when the tuning fork is placed on the mastoid process behind the examining ear and the time is being noted along with the procedure. Now the subject has pointed out that he has stopped hearing the tuning fork vibrations. You will immediately transfer the tuning fork to your own mastoid process and also check the time. But the examiner did not hear the tuning fork vibrations this time, which means that the subject heard the tuning fork vibrations longer than that of the examiner, which shows that the subject has conductive deafness. Okay, we have performed the Schwabach's test on the subject and compared it with that of the examiner for the right ear of the subject. We will repeat this procedure for the left ear as well. Now we will proceed with the modified Schwabach's test or the absolute bone conduction test. The only difference between these two tests is in this test, both the auditory meters of the examiner and the subject are plugged. So I will explain that to my subject and ask him to plug his both ears with the cotton plug, and the examiner will do that as well. So aap apne dono kano mein cotton plug ki madad se unko band kar le. Now the examiner will proceed with the absolute bone conduction test. He will strike the tuning fork on the rubber pad, start the stopwatch, and place the stem of the vibrating tuning fork behind the mastoid process of the right ear. The subject has pointed out that he has stopped hearing the vibrations. When he points it out, immediately transfer the stem of the vibrating tuning fork to your own mastoid process and also check the stopwatch. Now the examiner is still hearing the tuning fork vibration while the subject is not. So this shows that the subject has nerve deafness. Now we will suppose a condition or a situation in which the subject has conductive deafness. So in this case, the subject will hear the tuning fork vibration longer than the examiner. So we will proceed as before. The both auditory matrices of the subject and the examiner are plugged. The tuning fork will be striked on the rubber pad and its stem or base will be placed on the mastoid process behind the ear. When the subject points out that he has stopped hearing the tuning fork vibration, the time is checked on the stopwatch, and the examiner will transfer the stem of the tuning fork to his own mastoid process. But in this case, the examiner did not hear the tuning fork vibrations after the subject had stopped hearing it. So this showed that the subject heard the tuning fork vibration longer than the examiner, and this happens in conductive deafness. Students, now we will discuss the tests which are used to assess the vestibular function of the 8th cranial nerve. You know that the vestibular portion of the 8th cranial nerve is responsible to maintain the equilibrium of the body. So there are two tests which are used to assess the vestibular function of the 8th cranial nerve. The first one is the revolving chair test. In this, the subject is asked to sit on a revolving chair with open eyes. His head is flexed at an angle of 30 degrees with his chin almost touching his neck. The chair is then rotated quickly to the right side for about 20 seconds, or the chair is rotated for about 10 times. After that, the nystagmus in the eyes of the subject is noted. After this, the subject is asked to close his eyes and sit in the chair again, and the chair is revolved again. Chair is then abruptly stopped and the subject is asked to open his closed eyes. Check for nystagmus in the eyes of the subject and also note the position of the nystagmus. The same procedure is repeated while the subject rests his head on the left shoulder and then on his right shoulder. After this, the direction of post-rotational nystagmus is noted. So this was the revolving chair test to check the vestibular function of the 8th cranial nerve. Now we will discuss the caloric test or the oculovestibular reflex test to check the vestibular function of the 8th cranial nerve. The principle of this caloric test is that the semicircular canals in the ear are stimulated by instillation of water that is colder than the body temperature. The temperature difference creates convection currents in the endolymph of the vestibular apparatus with motion of the capilla, which results in nystagmus. The procedure of the caloric test is that the subject is asked to lie in supine position and the head of the subject is elevated at 30 degrees. 5 to 10 ml of ice cold water is instilled into the external air with a syringe. After that, quick nystagmus will occur in the eyes and it will occur towards the irrigated ear. So these are the two tests to check the vestibular function of the eighth cranial nerve. That was the entire clinical examination of the eighth cranial nerve. I hope that you understood it. Thank you.